Okay, shall we begin with a word of prayer? Amen. Okay, today we're going to look at this vision in early writings called the end of the 2300 days. There's some important aspects in there that I believe we have to understand. And we understand that all the prophets are speaking about the end of the world. Therefore, this vision is for us at the end of the world. So it says, I saw a throne, and on it sat the Father and the Son. I gazed, by the way, we're reading early writings 54 and paragraph 2. I gazed on Jesus' countenance and admired his lovely person. The Father's person I could not behold, for a cloud of glorious light covered him. I asked Jesus if his Father had a form like himself. He said he had, but I could not behold it. For, said he, if you should once behold the glory of his person, you would cease to exist. Before the throne, I saw the Advent people, hyphen, the church and the world. So, in this vision, she says she sees the Advent people, and so the Advent people are those that are waiting for Christ's return. And he sees the hyphen there annotates what it's referring to. He sees these two groups. It's the church and the world. Now, she goes on to say, I saw two companies. Now, I'm not 100% sure if these two companies are referencing these two things there, but they may well be. But if not, these two companies are referencing the church. But I have a feeling that it's referencing these two groups here, because she says she sees the Advent people, the church and the world, and then she sees two companies. So she's separating these two groups, but I'm open to correction on that. I saw two companies, one bowed down before the throne, deeply interested, while the other stood uninterested and careless. Those who were bowed down before the throne would offer up their prayers and look to Jesus. Then he would look to his Father and appear to be pleading with him. A light would come from the Father to the Son, and from the Son to the praying company. Then I saw an exceeding bright light come from the Father to the Son. From the Son it waved over the people before the throne, but few would receive this great light. Many came out from under it and immediately resisted it. Others were careless and did not cherish the light, and it moved off from them. Some cherished it and went and bowed down with the little praying company. This company all received the light and rejoiced in it, and their countenances shone with glory. So, you've got the little praying company. So, and another company. These are I'll just put uninterested company. So it tells us that the light comes from the Father to Christ, and it shines over this little praying company, and they all receive the light. But this company resists the light. Some of these eventually come and join with this company, but it's this company here, the little praying company, and it's a small company, it's not a big company. They receive the light. Okay, so it's all about, the vision's all about these two companies. One resists the light and one receives the light in a very simple way of looking at it. But we're going to talk more about that in a minute. So we're going to look now and try and understand who these two companies are. So I want to go to LA Ridings, page 88. And paragraph 2, it says, I saw the rapidity with which this delusion was spreading. Now this delusion is the wrapping, and the wrapping was spiritualism. So this was literal spiritualism. Back in that time, it was like demons communicating with human beings by knocking, and they were knocking back, and this was like some delusion. So at the end of the world, this is typifying something for us at the end of the world, but it's not literal knocking, but it's talking about spiritualism. And we understand spiritualism, how it's deceiving people at the end of the world, is through false doctrine. So it says, I saw the rapidity with which this delusion was spreading. A train of cars was shown me, going with the speed of lightning. The angel bade me look carefully. I fixed my eyes upon the train. It seemed that the whole world was on board and that there could not be one left. So she's saying, whoever's on this train, it's the world. So she sees the Advent people and she likens them to the church and the world. So that's what the hyphen there for is, differentiating between, there's two groups of people that are the Advent people, the church and the world. That's why I'm suggesting that it's these two companies here. This would be the church, the little praying company, and this would be the worldlings, the uninterested company. So, and this quote is going to sort of strengthen that idea, because it says about this people on the train, said the angel, they are binding in bundles ready to burn. So this is talking about the parable of the wheat and tares. And this is the tares that are being bound in bundles ready to be burned. And they're calling them, they're saying they're of the world. Then he showed me the conductor, who appeared like a stately fair person, whom all the passengers looked up to and reverenced. So the tares are looking up to and reverencing somebody. I was perplexed and asked my attendant angel who it was. He said, it is Satan. He is the conductor in the form of an angel of light. Now, there's nobody in this movement would claim to be reverencing Satan. But here it's saying Satan is in the person of an angel of light, right? So it's a deception. He has taken the world captive. They are given over to strong delusions. And strong delusions is what we find in 2 Thessalonians. It's given to those who don't have a love for the truth. So this is a war about truth and error. To believe a lie that they may be damned. This agent, the next highest in order to him, is the engineer. And the other of his agents are employed in different offices as he may need them. And they are all going with lightning speed to perdition. And Judas, he was called the son of perdition. So you see the tares, Judas, this is talking about a group here. And it would be out of these two groups, would be this group here. The world that's been classed as being on the train. I asked the angel if there was none left. He bade me look in an opposite direction. And I saw a little company traveling a narrow pathway. So again, here you have a little praying company, right, in contrast with the world. So I'm suggesting that this little praying company is the church. So I'm going to write that above there. And this uninterested company is the world. And I mean, well, as in their mindset, they're worldly minded. So I'll read that again. He bade me look in an opposite direction, and I saw a little company traveling a narrow pathway. Now we all know the vision of the narrow way, right? And this is probably the other vision that she's seeing here, this vision about the narrow way, traveling along that way. And we know in that vision that the little company put their whole weight upon the cords. It's on the lines, the reform lines. That's what's going to get them across this gulf here. It's putting their whole weight by faith upon the messages that have been given them. Just as we talk about that when we come to it, but it's all about faith in the way that God has led them in the past, the foundational messages. It says the third angel is binding or sealing them in bundles for the heavenly garner. So here you have the two groups based upon the parable of the wheat and tares. One group, the tares, are on a train going to perdition. So they're on a train to perdition. And this group is on the narrow way. This little company looked careworn, as if they had passed through severe trials and conflicts, and it appeared as if the sun had just risen from behind a cloud and shone upon their countenances, causing them to look triumphant, as if their victories were nearly won. Now, if we go to Matthew 13:30, in regards to the wheat and tares, it says, let both grow together until the harvest, and in the time of the harvest I will say to the reapers, gather ye together first the tares, and bind them in bundles to burn them, but gather the wheat into my barn. So this vision about the train with the conductor is the harvest. It's where two classes, one class is on a train going to perdition, they're being bound for the fires of destruction, and the other train are being bound into the gathered and bound into the heavenly garner. So you can see that it's a vision talking about this separation process that's taking place. Now, in the vision on that train, it was speaking about how Satan is the conductor, but it mentions him as an angel of light. So in 2 Corinthians chapter 11, we've covered this before, but I'm just bringing our minds back to it. 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 13 to 15 says, for such are false apostles, deceitful workers, transforming themselves into the apostles of Christ. And no marvel, for Satan himself is transformed into an angel of light. Therefore, it is no great thing if his ministers also be transformed as the ministers of righteousness, whose end shall be according to their works. And in Matthew chapter 7, verse 15, it says, beware of false prophets which come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ravening wolves. So there's this contrast. Satan comes as an angel of light. It's an outward display. It's something that bedazzles the eyes and the senses. You think, by looking, you think this is an angel of light, somebody that is a godly person, somebody that God has sent. But it's teaching us, as Christ had to fight Satan, he had to listen to the words that he was saying. It was about understanding whether it was truth or error coming forth from him that could determine. And we can see that this company doesn't rely on self, they rely on prayer. They're the little praying company, and they receive the light, and they're on a narrow way, but the uninterested company are being deceived by Satan, this angel of light. Okay? And the point is that when it talks about this in Matthew chapter 7, it just uses a different interpretation. It says, beware of false prophets which come to you in sheep's clothing. They have an outward display as an angel of light. They have an outward display as godly people. But inwardly, in their hearts, the message that they bear, because out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh. So the only way to determine is by the message. That's what's going to save you. You're either going to receive light and be on the narrow way, or you're going to resist light and be on the train to perdition. That is what this is teaching us. Two classes. All about truth, not about anything else. Now, just to finish off talking about the parable of the wheat and tares, in Christ Object Lessons, page 74, paragraph 2, Sister White talks about this parable. She says, "Not judgment and condemnation of others, but humility and distrust of self is the teaching of Christ's parable. Not all that is sown in the field is good grain. The fact that men are in the church does not prove them Christians." So, how you're going to determine who a wheat is over a tare is that the wheat is not judgmental, does not condemn others, but is in humility and distrustful of self, and he is a person that spends much time in prayer, because they realize that prayer is the breath of heaven. And through this is going to allow them to receive the light from heaven. Now, we're going to look at this now, this resisting of the light. This quote we're going to read is from Review and Herald, December 23rd, 1890. And we're going to begin as Art B, paragraph 18. "There is to be in the churches a wonderful manifestation of the power of God. But it will not move upon those who have not humbled themselves before the Lord and opened the door of the heart by confession and repentance." This is the wheat. They're confessing their sins, repenting, they're distrustful of self. Now, the vision that we saw in the beginning in Early Writings 54, we're going to see is just before October 22nd, 1844. Okay, it's just before October 22nd, 1844, and a great light is given to God's people, which leads them to that point. Now, we can show that right here, this is October 22nd, 1844 for us. It's the third angel when it arrives. It's the Day of Atonement, right? This is the Day of Atonement right here where the sins are blotted out. It's the third step. Repent ye, be converted, that your sins may be blotted out. So, October 22nd, 1844. Perfectly fulfilled here. This is where Christ comes to receive his kingdom, but he has to do the investigative judgment first before the marriage right here. This is where the third day where Esther comes and marries Ahasuerus. So there's an investigative judgment first before the marriage, and it's the binding off. It's where these two groups are going to be separated. Right? So just before this time here, there is a great light that's given to God's people. One group is going to accept that light and the other group is going to resist that light. And that light is preparing them for this period right here. So, it says, "In the manifestation of that power which lightens the earth with the glory of God, they will see only something which in their blindness they think dangerous, something which will arouse their fears, and they will brace themselves to resist it." This is this group right here, the majority, which are uninterested, and they're going to resist the light and end up on the train to perdition. "Because the Lord does not work according to their ideas and expectations, they will oppose the work. Why then, they say, should not we know the Spirit of God when we have been in the work for so many years? Because they did not respond to the warnings, the entreaties of the messages of God, but persistently said, 'I am rich and increased with goods and have need of nothing.'" So this group here is Laodicea, because Laodicea is rich and increased with goods and in need of nothing. It says, talent, long experience will not make men channels of light unless they place themselves under the bright beams of the Sun of Righteousness and are called and chosen and prepared by the endowment of the Holy Spirit. When men who handle sacred things will humble themselves under the mighty hand of God, the Lord will then lift them up. He will make them men of discernment, men rich in the grace of His Spirit. Their strong, selfish traits of character, their stubbornness, will be seen in the light, shining from the light of the world. I will come unto thee quickly, and will remove thy candlestick out of its place, except thou repent. If thou seek the Lord with all your heart, He will be found of you. Then it goes on to say, the end is near. We have not a moment to lose. Light is to shine forth from God's people in clear, distinct rays, bringing Jesus before the churches and before the world. Our work is not to be restricted to those who already know the truth. Our field is the world. The instrumentalities to be used are those souls who gladly receive the light of truth, which God communicates to them. These are God's agencies for communicating the knowledge of truth to the world. So, God has given a great light before October 22nd, 1844, to prepare them for this, because right here, you come out the belly of the whale and you stand before the kings of the earth and the Levites, and you're going to give them a message. And He's saying, these are God's agencies for communicating knowledge and truth to the world. But you have to receive the light to do that. If through the grace of Christ, His people will become new bottles, He will fill them with the new wine. God will give additional light, and old truths will be recovered and replaced in the framework of truth. And wherever the laborers go, they will triumph. As Christ's ambassadors, they are to search the scriptures to seek for truths that have been hidden beneath the rubbish of error. And every ray of light received is to be communicated to others. One interest will prevail, one subject will swallow up every other. Christ, our righteousness. So, Laodicea, rich and increased with goods and in need of nothing. So we're going to read another quote. It's from Review and Herald, August 19th, 1890, and we begin in paragraph 10. It says, the state of the church represented by the foolish virgins is also spoken of as the Laodicean state. So it's telling us the uninterested company are the foolish virgins. The true witness declares, I know thy works, that thou art neither cold nor hot. I would that thou were cold or hot. So then, because thou art lukewarm and neither cold nor hot, I will spew thee out of my mouth. Because thou sayest, I am rich and increased with goods and have need of nothing, and knowest thou not that thou art wretched, miserable, poor, blind, and naked. The five foolish virgins. I counsel thee to buy of me gold tried in the fire, that thou mayest be rich, and white raiment, that thou mayest be clothed, and that the shame of thy nakedness do not appear, and anoint thine eyes with eye salve, that thou mayest see. As many as I love and rebuke and chasten, be zealous therefore, and repent. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come into him and will sup with him, and he with me. So Christ is standing at the door, right? He's at the threshold and He's knocking right now. Half-hearted Christians obscure the glory of God. They misinterpret piety and cause men to receive false ideas as to what constitutes vital godliness. They are looking for an outward display rather than an inward purity. Others think that they also can be Christians and yet consult their own tastes and make provisions for the flesh. If these false-hearted professors can do so, on many a professed Christian's banner the motto is written, you can serve God and please self. You can serve God and mammon. They profess to be wise virgins, but not having the oil of grace in their vessels. With their lamps, they shed forth no light to the glory of God and for the salvation of men. They seek to do what the world's Redeemer said was impossible to do. He has declared he cannot serve God and mammon. Those who profess to be Christians but do not follow in the footsteps of Christ make of none effect his words and obscure the plan of salvation. So, we're going to look at that in a minute. They do not follow in the footsteps of Christ. It says, by their spirit and deportment, they virtually say, Jesus, in your day, you did not understand as well as we do in our day. That man can serve God and mammon. These professors of religion claim to keep the law of God, but they do not keep it. What would the standard of true manhood have become had it been left in the hands of man? God has lifted his own standard, the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. And the experience that follows complete surrender to God is righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. Everything that man touches with unholy hands and unsanctified intellect, even the gospel of truth, becomes by the contact contaminated. Man puts confidence in man and makes flesh his arm, but all the work of man is of the earth, earthy. So we need to put our complete trust in Christ, which is through the word, right? Can't trust any human being with our salvation. So it says that these people, they don't want to walk, they fail to walk. And the footsteps of Christ. So we're going to look at what those footsteps are. Let's go to Mark chapter 8. Mark chapter 8, verse 34. It says, and when he had called the people unto him, with his disciples also, he said unto them, whosoever will come after me, let him deny himself, and take up his cross, and follow me. Right? So, Christ has given us the command, we got to follow him, and we got to pick up our cross, and do that. Right? So, let's try and understand that. Now, I'm going to read from Bible Echo, November 15th, 1892, paragraphs 1 and 2. The great work of redemption could be carried out by the Redeemer only as he took the place of fallen man. Christ is our example in all things. Burdened with the sins of the world, he must pass over the path where Adam fell and redeem his failure. When Adam was assailed by the tempter, none of the effects of sin were upon him, but he was surrounded by the glories of Eden. But it was not thus with Jesus. For bearing the infirmities of degenerate humanity, he entered the wilderness to cope with the mighty foe, that he might lift man up from the lowest depths of his degradation. Alone, he was to tread the path of temptation and exercise self-control stronger than hunger, ambition, or death. So this is going to be our test. Right here, the binding off test. Satan is coming down as an angel of light. And he came down to Christ and tempted him three times. This is the Garden of Eden test.
Angel of light.
Oh, dear me. Excuse me. So, we're going to be tested by the same test that Christ went through, because he's our example in all things. And this was the same test that Eve and Adam failed in the Garden of Eden. So the Garden of Eden test for us is right here. It's the third step. And we're going to be tested on God's word. It is written. The scriptures are our safeguard. It's I'm trying to remember where I was there. Clothed as an angel of light, the artful foe presented his specious temptations to the Saviour. He sought to persuade Christ to turn from the path of self-denial and cross-bearing. So you see right here, when this angel of light comes down, he's going to try to turn Christ away from picking his cross up. And Christ has given us a command, you must pick your cross up and follow me. So you can see that a temptation of the devil is going to try to get you to prevent you doing that. He assured them that God was satisfied with his willingness to endure the trial, but that he stayed the hand of Abraham when he was about to sacrifice Isaac. So now, satisfied with Christ's willingness to set his feet in the bloodstained path, he had sent an angel to deliver him. So Satan's going to come down here and say that you have been delivered, when the actual deliverance is right here at point B, right? You got to be delivered out of the belly of the whale first, right? You've got to understand this. This Cestius comes here, but it's not until they flee away that you can escape, right? And they flee away right here. So this deception that Satan's going to bring upon God's people right here is that you're already delivered. You don't have to pick up your cross and follow me. You don't have to go to the cross. You don't have to do this. So we're going to see this, right? It's very important. He had sent an angel to deliver him from the long fast by which he was to overcome the power of appetite in man's behalf. This specious reasoning was a temptation to Christ. His humanity made it a temptation to him. And it was only by trusting his Father's word that he could resist the power of the enemy. He walked by faith, as we must walk by faith. It's the same test. And turned from the artful deceiver who feigned to doubt his divinity. So, let's go to Luke chapter 4 and verse 5. And we're going to see that this how important it is to understand this. Luke chapter 4, verses 5 to 8. It says, "And the devil, taking him up into an high mountain, showed unto him all the kingdoms of the world in a moment of time. And the devil said unto him, All this power will I give thee, and the glory of them, for that is delivered unto me, and to whomsoever I will give it." So the devil is offering you power in this temptation right here. "If thou therefore wilt worship me, all shall be thine. And Jesus answered and said unto him, Get thee behind me, Satan, for it is written, Thou shalt worship the Lord thy God, and him only shalt thou serve." So the devil comes to him, says, you don't have to go through this, you don't have to go to the cross, it's all done, you've been accepted. But Christ replies, "Get thee behind me, Satan." So the testimony of two is a thing established. Go to Matthew chapter 16. Matthew chapter 16, verses 21 to 24. It says, "From that time forth began Jesus to show unto his disciples how that he must go unto Jerusalem, and suffer many things of the elders and chief priests and scribes, and be killed and be raised again the third day." So Jesus is telling his disciples, I have to go to the cross. And he's talking about these 3 days of Friday, Sabbath, and the first fruits on the first day of the week. But it says, "Then Peter took him and began to rebuke him, saying, Be it far from thee, Lord, this shall not be unto thee." So Peter is saying, no, Lord, you don't have to do this. So what did Christ reply? "But he turned and said unto Peter, Get thee behind me, Satan. Thou art an offence unto me, for thou savourest not the things that be of God, but those that be of men." So God is telling you, you have to go to the cross. But man is going to tell you, you don't have to go to the cross. You've been delivered, because the angel of light comes as a wolf in sheep's clothing. It's men that are being controlled by Satan, and they're going to deceive the majority of people that are uninterested and do not receive the light here that's going to prepare them for this experience right here. Then said Jesus unto his disciples, if any man will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. Okay, this is the binding off. It's the where you're humbled into the ground, where all self is removed. Okay, Isaiah said, holy, holy, holy is a hot coal touches his lips and his sin is purged. It says there was hidden evil in his heart was revealed by the bright beams of the Sun of Righteousness. It says this will ever be the effect on the people of God. Right here, right? The Day of Atonement, it says there's a special work of a putting away of sin on this day right here. Okay, so there's corrupt things in our hearts that we're not aware of. And unless we go to the cross, right, we cannot be his disciple. So, Peter is a symbol of human strength, and Peter is one of the disciples. So, he's representing something on this movement that we have to understand. So, we'll go to the book of Mark, chapter 14, verses 27 to 30. It says, and Jesus saith unto them, all ye shall be offended because of me this night, for it is written, I will smite the shepherd, and the sheep shall be scattered. But after that I am risen, I will go before you into Galilee. But Peter said unto him, Although all shall be offended, yet will not I. And Jesus saith unto him, verily I say unto thee, that this day, even this night, before the cock crow twice, thou shalt deny me three times. So Peter is representing this group. This is Peter, the Pharisee. Okay, because Peter represents both groups. This is Peter, the Pharisee. Peter, the strong man that trusts in himself, does not humble himself before God and realize his own great need, but he thinks too highly of himself. In Matthew chapter 26, verses 51 and 52, it gives another representation of Peter. It says, and behold, one of them which were with Jesus stretched out his hand and drew his sword and struck his servant of the high priest and smote off his ear. Then said Jesus unto him, put up again thy sword into his place, for all they that take the sword shall perish with the sword. So, Peter is the symbol within this movement of those that trust in self. And right here, they're going to draw out their sword, which is a weapon, to try and destroy the enemies, right? And the Lord is telling Peter to put away the sword because he's saying that he could call upon 12 legions of angels. And if you have been watching the other presentations, you can show those 12 legions of angels represent this gathering huge army of Islam right here. It's a promise given to God's people. But you're not to try and use this weapon until you've gone through this test right here. Only then will you be the messenger of God to give the pronunciation which will be fulfilled by this army. They're the army that God is going to use to punish the heathen. We are not to take things in our own strength. So let's look at something else about Peter from Christ Object Lessons, page 152, paragraph 2. For each of the classes represented by the Pharisee and the publican, there is a lesson in the history of the Apostle Peter. In his early discipleship, Peter thought himself strong like the Pharisee. In his own estimation, he was not as other men were. When Christ, on the eve of his betrayal, forewarned his disciples, all ye shall be offended of me this night, Peter confidently declared, although all shall be offended, yet will not I. Peter did not know his own danger. Self-confidence misled him. He thought himself able to withstand temptation, but in a few short hours the test came, and with cursing and swearing he denied his Lord. The test for us is right here at midnight. So, a couple of quotes here just to warn us about this trusting in self, exalting self. It says, "The signs from Signs of the Times, February 26, 1885, paragraph 12. The only safe position for any of us to take is to consider ourselves sinners." Right, I'll say that again. The only safe position for any of us to take is to consider ourselves sinners. One of the themes of these people that are going to be on this train to perdition think themselves holy, right? It's one of the things that's going to manifest itself right here. These people will say that they are holy and will be breaking God's law. They will be doing miracles, okay? They will be filled with demons and they were going to cause many to be led astray. But she says the only safe position for any of us to take is to consider ourselves sinners, daily needing divine grace. Mercy through the atoning blood of Christ is our only plea. But let us shun Phariseeism. When it suits his purpose best, Satan can appear as an angel of light. So this angel of light is the angel that's going to deceive all the Pharisees. Okay, it's going to appeal to their fleshly senses. When it suits his purpose best, Satan can appear as an angel of light, but he presents before men not the meekness and humility of the Christian religion, but their own good deeds and wonderful impressions. We can meet his specious temptations only with the Word of God. Those who have the truth, as it is revealed in that holy word, must stand fast on the platform of truth, relying on "it is written." This is the little company. They put their whole weight on the cord. The question for each to settle is, am I exalting self or am I exalting God and his grace, seeking salvation through Christ alone? Next quote, Second Selected Messages, page 48. Let none cherish the idea that special providences or miraculous manifestations are to be the proof of the genuineness of their work or of the ideas they advocate. If we keep these things before the people, they will produce an evil effect, an unhealthful emotion. The genuine working of the Holy Spirit on human hearts is promised to give efficiency through the Word. Christ has declared the Word to be Spirit and life. The earth shall be filled with the knowledge of the glory of Jehovah as the waters cover the sea. Satan will work in a most subtle manner to introduce human inventions clothed with angel garments. Human inventions clothed with angel garments. It's human beings, it's false apostles, it's wolves in sheep's clothing. Outwardly, they look wonderful. Like the Pharisees, they were whitewashed sepulchres, but inside there had dead men's bones. And the only way the dead men's bones can be revived is through the three steps of the everlasting gospel, which is perfected here in the binding off. That's why you must go through this. But the light from the Word is shining amid the moral darkness, and the Bible will never be superseded by miraculous manifestations. The truth must be studied. It must be searched for as hidden treasure. Wonderful illuminations will not be given aside from the Word or to take the place of it. Cling to the Word. Receive the engrafted Word which will make men wise unto salvation. This is the meaning of the words of Christ in regarding to eating his flesh and drinking his blood. And he says, this is life eternal, that they might know thee, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom thou hast sent. So, We're going to now talk about how Christ here, through Sister White, is contrasting Peter and Judas. These are these two apostles. They both represent the majority in this movement. We're going to fall away. But they both seem to be manifesting two different traits that are going to manifest itself in this group. This is also Judas. It says, this is from Education, page 93, paragraph 3. The fall of Peter, the apostasy of Judas, their own failure in forsaking Christ in his anguish and peril swept away their self-sufficiency. So this group is self-sufficient, okay? They're uninterested in the light that's given them. They don't think they need it. They're rich and increased with goods and in need of nothing. But that self-sufficiency gets swept away at the binding off. Gospel Workers 4:14. It says, the Lord Jesus connected Judas and Peter with himself, not because they were defective in character, but notwithstanding their defects, he would give them an opportunity to learn in his school meekness and lowliness of heart, that they might become co-laborers with him. And if they would improve these opportunities, if they would be willing to learn, willing to see their deficiencies, and in the light of a pure example to become all that Christ would have them, then they would be a great blessing to the church. So, Judas and Peter, they're both representing the same thing, the same group of people, but they're showing different aspects of this, of the character traits of those people who are going to be in this group right here at midnight. So, this is a quote about Judas from Acts of the Apostles 5:57. In striking contrast to the sanctification worked out in the life of John is the experience of his fellow disciple, Judas. Like his associate, Judas professed to be a disciple of Christ, but he possessed only a form of godliness, an outward display. He was not insensible to the beauty of the character of Christ, and often, as he listened to the Saviour's words, conviction came to him. But he would not humble his heart or confess his sins. By resisting the divine influence, he dishonoured the Master whom he professed to love. John warred earnestly against his faults, but Judas violated his conscience and yielded to temptation, fastening upon himself more securely his habits of evil. The practice of the truths that Christ taught was at variance with his desires and purposes, and he could not bring himself to yield his ideas in order to receive wisdom from heaven. Instead of walking in the light, he chose to walk in darkness. He resisted the light. Evil desires, covetousness, revengeful passions, dark and sullen thoughts were cherished until Satan gained full control of him. And we all struggle with things in our heart. We've got to resist them through the power of the Holy Spirit. We've got to confess them. You've got to be part of this little praying company. You've got to realize that it's a need for light. We must study to show ourselves approved. We must be praying and asking the question, Lord, what must I do to be saved? I, not how must I reprove all these people here? That's self-righteousness. It's a need to humble ourselves and a realization that we need to pull the beam out of our own eye before we can be found worthy right here to pull the mote out of other people's eyes. So, back to our original quote from Ellie Ridens, page 55. So, it begins, paragraph 1, it says, I saw the Father rise from the throne. Now, this is the Day of Atonement. This is October 22nd, 1844. This is when the Father gets up and goes into the most holy place. So, just before that happened, there is a light that's poured out that one group resists and the other group receives, and it's preparing them for this right here. And we see the outcome right here. The majority that resist the light get on that train going to perdition, right? With Satan at the helm as an angel of light. It's the false apostles, these people that are leading them astray, that trust in themselves, okay? And that's the majority of people that put their trust in the arm of flesh. But this little company who don't trust in themselves, who trust merely in God's word, who receive the light, they are going to get through right here and give that. And it's open to everybody, brothers and sisters. Everybody has that opportunity to do that. So I saw the Father rise from the throne, and in a flaming chariot go into the Holy of Holies within the veil and sit down. Then Jesus rose up from the throne, and the most of those who were bowed down arose with him. Most. So most of those people here rise up and go with him. So even some of these don't follow Christ. I did not see one ray of light pass from Jesus to the careless multitude after he arose, and they were left in perfect darkness. Perfect darkness because they received not a love for the truth. So they're now receiving strong delusion, perfect darkness. Those who arose when Jesus did kept their eyes fixed on him as he left the throne and led them out a little way. Then he raised his right arm, and we heard his lovely voice saying, "Wait here. I am going to my Father to receive the kingdom. Keep your garments spotless, and in a little while I will return from the wedding and receive you to myself." Then a cloudy chariot with wheels like flaming fire, surrounded by angels, came to where Jesus was. He stepped into the chariot and was borne to the holiest, where the Father sat. There I beheld Jesus, a great high priest, standing before the Father. On the hem of his garment was a bell and a pomegranate, a bell and a pomegranate. Those who rose up with Jesus would send up their faith to him to the holiest and pray, "My Father, give us thy spirit." Then Jesus would breathe upon them the Holy Ghost. In that breath was light, power, and much love, joy, and peace. So, right here, the Father goes into the most holy place. This is the Day of Atonement. Christ is in here. It's the investigative judgment just before the marriage. And it says they're to wait here. They're to tarry, right? So they're now tarrying, right? We're going to talk about this tarrying time that's right in here. And he says he's going to come back in a little while. So I'm suggesting that right here is this little while before they get to the marriage. And we're going to show that from scriptures. So that to tarry in this period for a little while. Go to we'll quote Isaiah in a moment. John chapter 16, verses 19 to 21. It says, "Now Jesus knew that they were desirous to ask him. And he said unto them, Do ye inquire among yourselves of that I said, A little while, and ye shall not see me, and again, a little while, and ye shall see me. Verily, verily, I say unto you, that ye shall weep and lament, but the world shall rejoice. And ye shall be sorrowful, but your sorrow shall be turned into joy." So, two classes right here. One group is going to, it says, weep and lament, right? This group is going to weep and lament, but the world is going to rejoice, right? This is the brethren that rise up against their brethren right here. "Yeah, mine own familiar friend in whom I did trust, which did eat of my bread, hath lifted up his heel against me." This group lifts their heel up against this group right here. It says, "Ye shall weep and lament, but the world shall rejoice, and ye shall be sorrowful, but your sorrow shall be turned into joy. A woman, when she is in travail, hath sorrow, because her hour is come. But as soon as she is delivered of the child, she remembereth no more the anguish for joy that a man is born into the world. So we understand that the birth is right here. It's the belly of the whale. She begins to have her birth pangs right here, and she brings forth right here. This is where they're going to have joy. Okay, the deliverance, where Christ is going to deliver you, but there is a false deliverance right here. This deception represented by these false apostles who are going to say, you don't have to go through the binding off. Everything has been done here. You don't have to go through anything here. You're holy right here. You don't require this right here. And it's being said. I'm hearing it being said. Okay, so already those that are resisting the light are manifesting this very character, very thing that the Bible is warning about. Go to Isaiah chapter 10, verse 24. Therefore, thus saith the Lord God of hosts, O my people that dwellest in Zion, be not afraid of the Assyrian. He shall smite thee with a rod, and shall lift up his staff against thee after the manner of Egypt. For yet a very little while, and the indignation shall cease, and mine anger in their destruction. So we understand in the binding off, you got the work of Rome right here, represented by the Assyrian right here. He's the rod of his anger. He's going to smite God's people. There's a smiting here, and then God's people are going to smite them through Islam, right? They're going to prophesy, Islam's going to smite them. So it's classed as this, what's going on here by Assyria, as a little while. So this smiting is a little while. Go to Job 24:24. It's speaking about the wicked. It says they are exalted for a little while. So they're rejoicing and mocking this little company. They're exalted for a little while, but are gone and brought low. They are taken out of the way as all other, and cut off as the tops of the ears of corn. Right? First comes the blade, then the ear, and then the full corn in the ear. And immediately the fruit comes forth, that the sickle goes in, right? And it's marking it right here. They get to exalt themselves. But right here, the ear, they get cut off as the tops of the ears of corn. Psalm 37, verses 9 through 11. For evildoers shall be cut off, but those that wait upon the Lord, they shall inherit the earth. So the Lord says, wait here, tarry for me. For yet a little while, and the wicked shall not be. Yea, thou shalt diligently consider his place, and it shall not be. But the meek shall inherit the earth, and shall delight themselves in the abundance of peace. So those that exalt themselves, they're going to be abased, and those that abase themselves, they're going to be exalted. This is the promise of Christ. Now, go to Isaiah 54. We're going to see the same period, but uses slightly different language. Isaiah 54, verses 7 and 8. It says, for a small moment have I forsaken thee, but with great mercies will I gather thee. Right? We're going to show that this small moment is this little while. In a little wrath I hid my face from thee for a moment, but with everlasting kindness will I have mercy on thee, saith the Lord thy Redeemer. So we know that on the cross, right, represented by this period right here, the sixth to the ninth hour, that the Father hid his face from Christ. And it's going to be our experience. It's going to seem like that you've been rejected of God. You're going through this Garden of Gethsemane experience, where you've got to trust wholly on the promises of God. Okay, and you've got to remember that the Lord, although it's the darkest hour, it's midnight darkness, the Lord is right next to you. And we're going to see that here in Desire of Ages, page 753. There was a darkness over all the land until the ninth hour. There was no eclipse or other natural cause for this darkness, which was as deep as midnight. Without moon or stars, it was a miraculous testimony given by God that the faith of after generations might be confirmed. In that thick darkness, God's presence was hidden. He makes darkness his pavilion and conceals his glory from human eyes. God and his holy angels were beside the cross. The Father was with his Son, yet his presence was not revealed. Had the glory flashed forth from the cloud, every human beholder would have been destroyed. And in that dreadful hour, Christ was not to be comforted with the Father's presence. He trod the winepress alone, and of the people there was none with him. So Sister White says that have we seen the Father's glory, we would perish. But that's because we're not able to withhold his glory. But in this time period here, Christ is going to come right next to you, but he has to hide in the darkness so you don't get destroyed by his glory. But he's going to be right next to you through this whole experience, right? This is this small moment that he hides his face from you. Next quote from Signs of the Times, April 9th, 1894. The Lord says, "For a small moment have I forsaken thee, but with great mercies will I gather thee. In a little wrath I hid my face from thee for a moment, but with everlasting kindness will I have mercy on thee, saith the Lord thy Redeemer. Why will you carry your burden of sin, when Christ has come to be your burden bearer? Roll your sins at the foot of the cross. Unload, unload. He takes away the sin of the world. I am he that blotteth out thy transgressions for mine own sake and will not remember thy sins." This is the blotting out of sins, and it's done at the cross. You're to roll your sins at the foot of the cross. It's a special working of putting away a sin. All known sin is put away in the preparation time. But right here, Isaiah, Job, Paul, Ezekiel, all the prophets confess their wickedness right here. They confess that they are sinners. They don't think of themselves high and holy and lifted up, right? The closer you come to Christ, the less you think of yourself. It's the opposite. Anybody that says they're holy and overcome their sin, flee from that man. Flee from him. Hebrews chapter 10, verses 35-39. "Cast not away therefore your confidence, which hath great recompense of reward. For ye have need of patience, that after ye have done the will of God, ye might receive the promise. For yet a little while, and he that shall come, and will not tarry." See, he's tarrying right here. But he's going to come right here. This is the first coming of Christ where he goes to the cross. This is the second coming of Christ where he comes as to receive his people at the marriage. He comes as a conqueror. "Now the just shall live by faith. But if any man draw back, my soul shall have no pleasure in him. But we are not of them who draw back unto perdition, but of them that believe to the saving of the soul." These people, they draw back unto perdition. They're on the train to perdition. They don't believe that you have to go through this little period here, through the cross, the binding off. They don't believe that there's a special working of putting away of evil in your heart that you're not aware about. That when this angel comes down here, not this angel of light, but this angel comes down with this flying roll and says, "Eat it," it's going to reveal the deformity of your heart. All self will be gone. You will be completely Christ forevermore. That's only if we heed the words of Christ. So let's go to 2 Kings chapter 2, verses 1 through 7. And this is a story of where Elijah passes on the mantle to Elisha. This is the story, the same story that's represented in the vision of the narrow way. Vision of the Narrow Way, they have to put their whole weight on the cords. And we're going to see this is a representation in this story. In verse 1 it says, "And it came to pass, when the Lord would take up Elijah into heaven by a whirlwind, that Elijah went with Elisha from Gilgal. And Elijah said unto Elisha, Tarry here, I pray thee, for the Lord hath sent me to Bethel. And Elisha said unto them, As the Lord liveth, and as thy soul liveth, I will not leave thee. So they went down to Bethel." So Elijah is doing a tour of the schools of the prophets. He's going to go to three of them, right? One, two, three. And each time he's testing Elisha to see if he will leave Elijah. Elijah being the message, right? Okay. And when he gets to the to Bethel, the sons of the prophets that were at the school in Bethel came forth to Elisha and said unto him, "Knowest thou that the Lord will take away thy master from thy head today?" And he said, "Yea, I know it. Hold ye your peace." Now, it doesn't say it here, but you can show they're mocking him, right? They're not paying attention. They're paying very much lip service to this fact, right? They don't actually believe that that's going to happen. Verse 4, "And Elijah said unto him, Elisha, tarry here, I pray thee, for the Lord hath sent me to Jericho. And he said, As the Lord liveth, and as thy soul liveth, I will not leave thee. So they came to Jericho. And the sons of the prophets that were at Jericho came to Elisha and said unto him, Knowest thou that the Lord will take away thy master from thy head today? And he answered, Yea, I know it. Hold ye your peace. And Elijah said unto him, Tarry, I pray thee, here, for the Lord has sent me to Jordan. And he said, As the Lord liveth, and as thy soul liveth, I will not leave thee. And they too went on. And 50 men of the sons of the prophets went out and stood to view far off, and they too stood by the Jordan." So, there's three tests, and it leads to the number 50, to Pentecost. This is Mount Sinai, where this mighty message is going to be given. 50 men of the sons of the prophets. These are all schools of the prophets, so it's showing that it's talking about this movement, the people that are studying at schools of the prophets all across the world. These little places are being set up, but it's showing that the majority of the people are going to mock Elisha. They're not going to really believe this test, this three-step test that's going on here, and we're going to see that. Verse 15. "And when the sons of the prophets which were to view at Jericho saw him, they said, The spirit of Elijah doth rest on Elisha. And they came to meet him and bowed themselves at the ground before him." Okay, there's another story where the people of God bowed down before Joseph, right? This is a realization, a perception. In verse 16, "And they said unto him, Behold now, there be with thy servants 50 strong men," right? These are the men that relied in human strength. 50 strong men, "let them go, we pray thee, and seek thy master, lest peradventure the Spirit of the Lord hath taken him up, and cast him upon some mountain or into some valley, and he said, Ye shall not send." Now he says, don't go, because he knows you're not going to find him. Because Elisha represents this group that didn't trust himself, that received the light, that understand prophecy. This group didn't receive the light, don't believe in this binding off message, and they're going to reject and make mockery of this binding off period right here. And they're martyrs, 50 strong men. And they go begin to look for Elijah, the message, right? The message that came in this time period, this preparation time where we're learning the message line upon line, they go looking for it and they can't find it. They can't cross this chasm right here because they don't have the cord to put their weight on. Okay, they're uninterested. Desire of Ages 7:45 says, "As soon as Jesus was nailed to the cross, it was lifted by strong men and with great violence thrust into the place prepared for it." So there's always this reference of strong men. These are the Rome. It's this, there's this Babylonian mindset. It's to trust in flesh. It's a salvation through human works. Okay, and this is this great deception, this false sanctification that's going to sweep away many in this movement right here. Last quote. Early writings 56.1. I turned to look at the company who were still bowed before the throne. They did not know that Jesus had left it. Satan appeared to be by the throne, trying to carry on the work of God. I saw them look up to the throne and pray, Father, give us thy spirit. Satan would then breathe upon them an unholy influence, and in it there was light and much power, but no sweet love, joy, and peace. Satan's object was to keep them deceived and to draw back and deceive God's children. So they were getting draw back unto perdition. So even some of this little group here, and it's little, are going to be deceived by the deceptions of this angel of light right here. And brothers and sisters, this message is sent to warn us. We must distrust self. We must distrust the flesh. Okay? Romans 8:1 says, there's now no condemnation to those in Christ Jesus who walk after the Spirit and not after the flesh. And I pray that this message would be heeded and this would be our experience. Amen. Shall we close with a word of prayer? Dear Heavenly Father, we want to thank you for your messages of reproof. I want to pray for a constant conviction from the Holy Spirit of our great need and to wake us from our lethargy, to help us to see how close midnight is and how much we are in need of thee, Lord, to be cleansed, to be purified, to have all self divested from our hearts, that we might be like the man on the mat, completely devoid of any human strength and in holy and total need of the strength of Christ, which is promised to us. If we shall take hold upon his strength, that he will make peace with us. And I pray that that would be our plea, Lord. And we ask this in the name of Jesus. Amen.